The rarity of an action figure is typically accepted as something that's hard to find, generally uncommon, and not found in substantial quantities. At least, not very often. Sometimes, you find a rare figure, but it's not in a condition or a completion level that's satisfactory to make the cut for your personal collection. In today's video, we take a look at the 10 rarest Transformers figures in my personal collection, and that list is up next.
Hi everyone, this is Ken with Toy Kennections. If you would like to see more figure reviews, figure comparisons, toy histories, collection footage, and toy insights in general, please be sure to hit subscribe, click that notification bell, and press like.
For the purpose of this list, we will stick only to Transformers figures in the Generation 1 toy line, whether they were released domestically or internationally. As much as I can, I'm going to try to share with you a personal story for at least some of these entries so that you can see how my connection developed with these particular action figures. And if you have a different list, I would love to hear about it in the comments because I feel that's what collecting is about. It's about sharing. It's about talking about the differences between your collection and mine. So again, I'd love to hear about it. Anyway, without further ado, let's get to our list.
Kicking things off in the opening spot is the mail-away known as Reflector. Originally a part of Takara's Microchange line previously, he was made available via mail-in offer during 1986 and 1987, which, interestingly enough, was long after his initial appearance in the Transformers Sunbow animated series. In my case, I actually remember sitting in my living room, cutting out robot points on the back of other figure cards to mail them in to get Reflector. The only problem was, I was too young to know how to use a pair of scissors, and hence, my older brother cut them out for me, and we asked my mom to help us mail them in. Sometime later, I came home to a package in the mail, and I actually remember being pretty underwhelmed by the almost plain white box that simply had the words Transformers Camera on it, seeing as Reflector was never sold outside of Japan in a standard issue box with proper box art. I wondered, where was the Transformers logo? Where was the usual box art? I wondered this to myself. However, all that stopped mattering when I slipped the box open and revealed the three figures I am showing you here today. The fun part about the story is, this Reflector shown is indeed my childhood one from the 1980s, hence some stickers were misapplied by my preschool level self. However, all the accessories including the spare missile somehow survived throughout the decades. I had tons of fun changing him back and forth from his three robot modes into his merge camera mode many times over. And while he isn't as rare as the other figures on or off this list, the fact that he's a mail away and my personal connection to the memory of mailing him in and receiving him on my doorstep makes him worthy of a top 10 spot on this list. In the number 9 spot, we take a look at the largest Transformer released in the Generation 1 toy line. Standing just under 22 inches tall is 1987's Fortress Maximus. And while finding a Fortress Maximus in any condition might be easier than finding a mail-away Reflector, the fact that this one comes with the box and styrofoam adds to the rarity of this particular figure. Add to the fact that it wasn't exactly the type of gift you could ask for birthdays and Christmas, given its size. It's one I didn't own in my youth and always marveled at the ones that I did see at friends' houses. However, the Fortress Maximus you see here isn't actually the one that I started with. The first time I got one was back in 2005, which I had bought as a university graduation gift to myself. That figure was significantly incomplete, missing a ton of accessories, and was in average condition at best. With all those accessories to hunt down, I ended up chipping away over the years to try and complete him. And the best part of the story is I was able to find the final two pieces, namely the two ramps behind his arms, to complete him at the BotCon convention in Florida in 2010. Kind of a cool part, just because I completed him at an actual Transformers convention. However, as the years went by, even after this, I did begin to think about upgrading the figure's condition, particularly as mine was quite yellowed and did have some cracks on the figure itself. Many years later, my friend Jeff sold me one with the box, and after buying it, I took the two Fortress Maximus figures and kept the better condition accessories, better condition figure, and the box to end up with the one that I am showing you here today. All of that adds to the personal mission to put him in my collection in the shape that he is in. Fortress Maximus has always had a certain appeal to him, not just because of his size, but because he also had that headmaster within a headmaster gimmick, and it was the first time that we saw Spike released in the Transformers toy line, which, if you're a fan of the cartoon, you'll know why that's important. As we move on, the next figure in this entry is the Diaclone version of Thundercracker. While this is technically a pre-Transformer that predates the original Generation 1 toy line, it's important to include him on this list because it's really the only time I've actually ever seen this particular version in hand after all my years of collecting. Originally released under the simple name of Jet Robo in the early 1980s, I find these original Diaclone and Microchange figures are getting harder and harder to find. I got this one all the way back in 2003 at a local store, and although it's missing the missiles and the feet on the Diaclone driver, I always remembered how mystifying it was to hold such an uncommon version at the time. The jets were always a significant part of the Generation 1 Transformers lore, and if I'm being honest, I was a third year student at the time and wasn't sure I wanted to splurge the money, but I snagged it in fear of never running into it again. In hindsight, it turned out to be a good decision, and it is due to that decision that I am able to share this figure with you here today. I have always been mesmerized at finding Takara-produced figures that came before the G1 toy line, and I'll always remember that this one was my first. Now, while we're on the topic of Diaclone, the number 7 spot goes to the Diaclone version of Grimlock, or Dinosaur Robot as he was called during his pre-Transformer years. The Dinobots have always been popular, and I don't know about you, but I often called dibs on playing the role of Grimlock on my school playground during recess time. Didn't matter to me that he wasn't the smartest member of the Autobot lineup, he got to play the role of stomping Decepticons at will, and that was good enough for elementary school Ken. This version has a blue-colored waist, which differentiates him from the G1 1985 mainline release, and I like displaying them side by side so I can see the G1 figure I grew up with alongside the originally produced figure that he originated from. Unfortunately, mine is missing the silver-colored sword that he came with, but I do have faith that I will find it someday. The reason this makes the list is that I've wanted one for as long as I've known about its existence, and only in the spring of 2021 did I manage to get my hands on it. I hesitated to pull the trigger at first, simply because he was being sold as part of a larger lot, but snagged it because I'd waited long enough to find one, and I realized if I passed this up, who knows how long it would be before I'd be able to see one again. As mentioned previously, these pre-Transformers seem to be getting harder to find, and when I do see an opportunity to get the ones that I've been targeting for a lengthy period, rest assured, I'll do my best to make it happen. It makes the list just marginally ahead of the Jet Robo Diaclone Thundercracker because it's much closer to being complete. In, at number 6, is the 1988 Godmaster from the overseas-released Masterforce series, Overlord. Assembled into a tower of a vintage robot from his separate jet and tank modes, this vintage figure stands at a very impressive 14 inches in height and can stand eye-to-eye with some of the largest Generation 1 Transformers. Now, while I personally have no childhood connection to this character, he did appear and was a dominant force in the Transformers IDW continuity, among other media appearances. He was the key villain in the 2010 critically acclaimed Last Stand of the Wreckers story, where he duked it out with Springer, Impactor, and the best that the Wreckers team had to offer. And it is at this time that I'd like to recommend that comic story to those of you who have yet to read it and are curious. It is an amazing, memorable story. The vintage figure was released by Hasbro in Europe and by Takara in Japan. My version is the European release, and I do enjoy this figure a lot, mostly for his towering, intimidating, and villainous presence on my toy shelf. As we head into the top 5, this spot goes to the 1989 Victory Saber gift set. Comprised of both Star Saber and Victory Leo from the Japanese released Transformers Victory series, this is yet another figure that, when assembled, towers over most of your other vintage toys. While it's arguable that Overlord at number 6 alone is more rare than either of these figures individually, finding both these figures together plus having the gift set box with styrofoam squeaks this into my top 5. While my C328 gift set box is in pretty rough shape, I am glad simply to have it, just as it doesn't pop up very often. My childhood connection to this set is actually a very unique one. Years after its release, I had a family friend from overseas come to town in 1994, and while playing in the living room, he broke out this gift set, and I had never seen it before at the time, seeing as it was never released domestically. As we couldn't read the Japanese printing, my friend simply named this figure as his own Super Robot, and he duked it out with me in a crossover of battle with my vintage Power Rangers Megazord in the living room. This memory is seared into my mind as a happy, more innocent time in my life, and for years after, I wondered what the origin of these figures were, and it was a long time after before I knew that they were officially called Star Saber and Victory Leo. Flash forward then to 2004, when I did find Star Saber, and in 2016, Victory Leo joined him on my shelf. And if you remember my friend Jeff, who helped me find the box for Fortress Maximus, well, he's the same person who found me the C328 Victory Saber box and foam. Cheers, buddy. You've helped my collection grow to the state that it's become. In at number 4 is the Canadian exclusive known as Red Slag. This variant is particularly notable as he resembles the old Sunbow cartoon appearance more accurately than his mainline 1985 released counterpart. This exclusive not only has more red color featured on it, but white colored legs and a red launcher to differentiate him from his aforementioned regular release. I picked up this one from my good friends at Cherry Bomb Toys in Victoria, British Columbia, Canada, when I saw it posted on their Instagram account in the summer of 2018. Moral of the story? Make some connections, support your mom and pop toy stores, and scour social media to get the figures that you want. Hey, what can I say? It worked for me. I will have to admit though that, being Canadian myself, I am quite partial to this figure, given its original Canadian exclusivity back in the day. Now, as we head into the final three and close things out with the home stretch, you will notice a bit of a pattern on my list. The value of the figures isn't the only determining factor, but I've worked in my personal experiences with how hard it's been for me to find some of these toys using my usual outlets. I've met some great friends with even more rare and desirable figures than the ones on this list, and I can only hope that my collection can hold a candle to theirs. And for those who may not be familiar with some of these figures, be sure to let me know what you like about them and how you might collect differently from me in the comments. Alright, into the top three we go. In at third place, another Japanese release, the D306 gift set release of Hydra and Buster. Released in 1988 as part of the Masterforce series, these figures also saw domestic releases in the same year in the form of Darkwing and Dreadwind, albeit in a different color scheme. The Japanese gift set release is the first one that I've held in hand throughout my years of collecting, and it does indeed come with the original catalog and vintage instruction set. Also considered as Godmasters, or Power Masters in North America, they were part of the Decepticon force alongside Overlord. This Japanese gift set is not one that I remember as a child, although I enjoy it all the same given that I do prefer this color scheme over their domestic counterparts. In at number 2 is this variant of the already rare mini-bot known as Bumblejumper, or Bumper for short. While the original yellow Bumblejumper was mispackaged domestically on Cliffjumper cards in 1984, this version wasn't released by Hasbro. Instead, it was released by the company known as Estrela in Brazil, under the Transformers series and simply known as Blue Robo Car Sedan. While it was released in the mid-1980s, I found this figure in 2004 at a local gathering of Transformers collectors. At that time, I had never heard nor even seen any version of this particular figure outside of the yellow one, but I was on the hunt for some form of Bumblejumper anyway. The collector who sold this to me gave it to me at a fantastic price, and I would not learn of its value nor its rarity till much later. That collector also told me about the history of this figure, including some of the facts about the Estrela company and South American Transformer releases that I had never heard prior to this time. Since many collectors have either moved or lost contact after this period, I never did get a chance to properly thank this individual for allowing me to purchase this figure, so hence, we have this video here in case he ever sees it. These Estrela releases pop up pretty seldomly, even on eBay. The fact that he's blue though makes him more special to me, not just because it's my favorite color, but also because he stands out among my mini-bots more clearly, seeing that he's a different color than Bumblebee or Cliffjumper. I have had a few folks try to buy this figure off me and offer me far more than I paid for it all those years ago, but for now my answer remains the same. Thanks, but no thanks. Maybe someday, but just not today. This figure is important to me, as is the story of how I obtained it. Now, before we get to the number one spot on this list, I just want to emphasize that the blue Bumblejumper and the Buster and Hydra gift set are important to me, but the number one spot can only go to one figure amongst my G1 Transformers collection. Deathsaurus, the Decepticon leader from the 1989 Transformers Victory series. Now, while I have seen a few more of these than I have of the blue Bumblejumper, Deathsaurus takes the top spot because of the box, the styrofoam insert, instructions, the original catalog, and get this, an unapplied sticker sheet. And now, I've got another cool story for you. If you remember the same friend who visited me in 1994 that had the Victory Saber set, he also had this figure. Again, with neither one of us able to read the names in Japanese, he simply referred to this as his Flying Dragon. And of course, that lit a bit of a fire under me as we did our crossover battles in the living room. Well, what did I do? Of course, I had my Green Ranger summon the mighty Dragon Zord, and the two dragons would duke it out for what felt like a long time, in a memory that is near and dear to me. Known as the Decepticons' Emperor of Destruction, Deathsaurus had two transforming chest plates, as well as a pretty impressive looking shield and weapon. A sworn enemy of the Autobots, he's every bit as vile and ruthless as Megatron. And if I may add, he has a more impressive vintage toy. This figure is big enough to be more than a match for any of the best Autobots, whether he's locked in battle with Star Saber or any other powerful robot. There's only a handful of figures that I can think that would topple this from the number one spot in my personal collection, but offhand, I can think of a few white whales I would like to chase down in the years to come.
And that was the list of the 10 rarest Transformers Generation 1 action figures in my personal collection. I would love to revisit this list sometime in the future and see how it changes, and how my collecting habits evolve over the years, and see what continues to make the list and what no longer makes the list. As they say, collecting's a marathon, not a sprint, and I'd love to hear what you guys have to say in the comment section. Otherwise, that was today's video. Please like and subscribe if you already haven't. Follow me on Instagram, and I'll see you again soon with some more cool and fun toys. Take care, everybody.